And welcome back, brothers and sisters, once again to YouTube Teachings. We're in the Gospel of St. John, John 14. And beginning to read at verse 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. Our message today is the love of God. If you love me, keep my commandments. This is what a relationship with God through His Son Jesus Christ, by the moving and penning of the Holy Ghost in our hearts, in letter, in scripture, in prophecy, in singing of hymns and songs, the moving of the Holy Ghost to the believer is all about. If you love me, keep my commandments. In loving the Lord, we present ourselves to Him to hear the word, to worship Him, to hear the gifts moving amongst the brethren. As we present ourselves, He moves. If we love Him, we keep the commandments. And the commandments is to fellowship together and to be available, that whatever gifts God has put on us, given to us, that they would be able to move with and through us. And so, if we love Him, keep His commandments, make ourselves available, do what He says. Of course, when you're in love with Jesus, you want to do everything that He says. In the beginning, you have to be careful you don't desert your family, because folks want to run here and there, and it's not always God. A lot of the flesh can get in, but God loves us and He understands. But we've got to bring it to where it's God first, family second, and ministry third. We don't let those overlap. And believe we're ministering all for the Lord and the family be neglected. Or believe that we've got ministry for the Lord and we're working and helping our own family, and we have absolutely no time to help our neighbor or some of the brothers or sisters that need help within the fellowship. There's a way to do things. And wisely dividing up our time in how and where we do things. Being careful. If you love me, keep my commandments. Work on those three things along with prayer and fasting. Reading of your word, and the words you read, those parts that sit out to you or parts that you don't quite understand, meditate on those. Ask the Lord to break them open to you. Ask the Lord to stretch and help them to your mind and your heart. Praise the Lord. And he says then in verse 21, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. It couldn't be any plainer. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. If we love the Lord, we're told here, he will be loved by the Father. And he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, you see, once again, as much as those that are rebelling against God don't want to hear his commandments, we who are running as the deer panteth after the water brook, we're running after the Lord, we're seeking the Lord, we want to hear His commandments. You see, whatever God shows us to do, the word commandments doesn't frighten us or put a yoke on us. Obeying God to us is not legalism. He said, take my yoke upon you, it's easy and light. We love to do this, so it's not a problem. But those who are filled with self and can still say praise the Lord, still worship with the hand extended in the sanctuary, the Bible will tell us in a little moment, you'll know them by their fruit. Rebellion will show out. Unkindness will show out. Greediness and selfishness will show out. You will know them by their fruit. So for us that's working with the Lord and following the Lord, presenting to the Lord our mistakes, if we fail or slip up, We're quick to say to the Lord, I'm sorry, Lord, forgive me, help me. And so the Christian walk goes on. We continue to grow. And this is what it's all about, going and growing in the Lord. 23, Jesus said, if a man love me, he will keep my words. Now, notice the prefaces on this. If a man love me, he will keep my words. Now, this is Jesus asking this question. If a man love me, he will keep my words. He will get them, keep them, and do them. And my Father will love him. And we, now it's plural, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. He's bringing the Father's word, and when you hear him speak, he's just speaking for the Father. Now, Jesus will obey the Father. He has the fear of God. He will do what the Father says, and he will speak those, and it's the Father speaking them through him. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings. Now, it could not be any more simpler here. If a man love me, he will keep my words. If he loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings. So when a person isn't doing what God wants him to do, you see, he says they don't love him. If a man love me, and he that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings. So when he's not obeying God, not keeping his sayings, this is saying he doesn't love me. Now, I'm not talking about slipping off occasionally and backing up selfishly and not doing what the Lord said a time or two and repenting and making it right, even with others that knew or heard or were involved, making things right. I shouldn't have did that. I was wrong and I led you astray by that. Always keeping short accounts and keeping it right, and you will walk in the Holy Ghost. Keep short accounts. If a man love me, he will keep my words. We know when we haven't kept the Lord's words. The anointing abideth in us. The Holy Spirit will convict us, because he's the Holy Spirit of conviction and the love of God shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Ghost. Two things will happen. He will convict us, and he will love us, and if we confess, he will cleanse us. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings. We might help them, exhort them to follow on hard to know the Lord. People get very irate when you say you're judging me. Well, we shouldn't judge ever unto condemnation, but unto salvation. If they've got badly out of the way, if they have lost their first love, you say, well, you're judging to see that, and you don't know the whole picture. Well, don't judge them. But when you know the picture, that they're not living for God, and you know their sins, and you know they're in danger, you're not a faithful brother. You're not a Christian man or Christian woman that loves God if you don't speak up and say, may I help? These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. And if we keep these short accounts and we obey the Lord, because if we love him, we'll obey him. If we do that, we will feel his presence. There'll be nothing between us and the Lord. If we love, we keep. And if we keep, we share the things that God shows us. And in sharing them, others grow. People will know if we're walking in the Spirit, if we have the fruits of the Spirit, if we do share our goods, if we are kind, if we will pick someone up for church, if we will give someone a ride to work, if we will help in their difficulties and the different tragedies that can happen, if we make ourselves available. That's a key phrase around here, making ourselves available. If we abide in His love. So now we want to be in John 15, just over the page. John 15, verse 17. These things I command you, that you love one another. In fact, I would like to start at verse 1. I hadn't intended to, but verse 1 of chapter 15. 15 chapter of John, beginning to read at verse 1. I am the vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, in this love of God, this so kind of love, here is His love again. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh it away, and every branch that beareth fruit, the non-good branches, that which doesn't need to be there, he takes it away. And the branch that beareth fruit, he purges or prunes it, that it may be healthy, that it may bring forth more fruit. 3. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Get yourself under the word. Wherever you find the word, some dear brother who sold out to God his book, a video, YouTube, wherever the word is being preached with love and without compromise, get sitting in under the spout, the water font of the Word of God. The Word of God is that water that washes and cleanses us from the things of the earth. Verse 4, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except you abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is, oh dear, if a man abideth not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. Once saved, always saved will not work here. Cast forth and withered. 7. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples indeed. People will know by your fruit bearing that you are a disciple of Jesus Christ. And the Father hath loved me, or as the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. This so kind of love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love. You see, here it is again. We have to get used to the fact. We have to put ourselves in after Christ, following him. We have to walk in his footsteps. We have to keep ourselves in his love. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If you keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Now you see here how Jesus can teach this way, because he keeps the Father's commandments. He has the right to ask us to keep his. 11. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. When the Lord's joy remains in you, You and I have a wonderful life. We have a wonderful, joyous time. This is my commandment. Now, there's no suggestion in this. There's no good advice in this. This is the absolute. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. You cannot say you love God and teach heresies. You cannot say you love God and go around discouraging people who want to live and are striving to live sold out and holy. And you say, oh, you're just old-fashioned. There's no need for that in this modern time. Greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. All I can say is you either want to embrace this, you love to embrace this, or this is a very tiresome thing to you. That is, being told continually. I mean, it's just every verse here. Commanding, telling, following, walking, doing what he says. You are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. I guess that's what causes God's sold out, end time, blood bought remnant to know ahead of time before it hits what's going on. When the different false revivals, when the different false prophecies and teachers arrive, we know ahead of time because he teaches us. He's made it known to us. Ye have not chosen me, verse 16, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, that you love one another. If the world hate you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because you're not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. The day the city council gives us commendation and accepts us in the town hall and the cities, the day that we are offered help by the worldly crowd, we are not walking after the Lord. We're concentrating on pleasing men. We're compromising. If the world hit you, you know that it hated me before you. 20. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will persecute also you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. If I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin. But now that they have no cloak for their sin, he that hateth me hateth my Father also. If I had not done among them the works which were done other men did, they had not had sin. But now have they both seen and hated me, both me and my Father. But this cometh to pass, that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law, they hated me without a cause. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. And ye shall also bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. If we do what the Father wants, then we will receive the same persecution that Jesus received. But the Comforter will be there and proceed out of the Father to help and to see us walking in the right passage. There is this whole matter And perhaps this is what this entire section of our message is about, bringing ourselves into this one position, doing what the Lord commands, doing what the Lord commands, abiding in His love, and make yourselves available towards our family and working and helping them, towards the church, the brothers and sisters, in visitation, friendliness, in work, being a good witness and clean on the job, on time, loving the Lord through our work, loving the Lord through in the church, reaching out, and in missions, being willing to go on weekend missions, our holiday, our vacation, we could take the week and join up with a mission team and go out into all the world, in alms, being available with a little piece of money in the back of the wallet, that when we see someone poor, there's so many poor today, and no one to take a moment and give them a track and buy them a McDonald's. These things, being available towards those things. In Philippians 2:21 it says, we are to live for God and His purposes. Philippians 2:21. For all men seek their own, and not the things that be of Jesus Christ. That's a huge indictment from the Apostle Paul. All men seek their own. We're to live for God and God's purposes. Jude 21 will tell us to keep ourselves in the love of God, obviously through prayer and seeking God, but we are to keep ourselves. And we know, if we know God and God's love, we know how to keep ourselves in that love, because we certainly know when we've stepped out of it. We feel that vacant spot where the Holy Spirit was when we step out of the will. Amen? And so we don't want to continue to do that in that pathway to discover it's overtaken us to where we've left our first love. That's not a quick thing. That's not something, an overnight thing, to leave the first love. At the beginning, you won't know you're growing cold, but it will catch you up and trip you up and find you out if we keep not walking the way the Lord wants us to walk. It's easier to walk after the Lord one day at a time. And if we're not communing with God and we haven't prayed, well, talk to Him. Fix it. But don't come on to condemnation because you missed a morning and getting to work and didn't pray. That's what the devil wants, is to condemn you in what was a genuine slackness or a mistake. Amen. You can make it up. You can tell the Lord immediately, I'm sorry. And find a quiet moment or two in the day and talk to God. It's not a legalistic bondage. How would you feel if your wife or husband didn't say good morning, didn't say I love you, didn't say I'll see you later on this evening? This is a love relationship with God, not a bondage. And so if we don't keep walking with the Lord, you might hear Him to say, where are you, son? Where are you, daughter? So we want to keep that walking with the Lord. And so it's faith that worketh by love. If you find at times it's difficult to do what the Lord says because you feel your faith is being tested to where it's not been put out to that test before, Galatians 5 will tell us it's faith that worketh by love. So we're back to the love of God, this so kind of love. If we keep talking to the Lord and walk in that love, the faith needed will come. In 1 John 4:18 it says, there is fear. Let's go there. 1 John. Thank you, Jesus. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love Him because He first loved us. There is no fear in love. And this is why we're to keep ourselves, as the scripture said, in the love of God. Then, when we are being made available and something comes up that we know we should step into, we haven't got this huge wall of fear to get through. We love him because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, verse 20, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? And this commandment we have from him, that he who loveth God loveth also his brother. Doing what's right. Doing what's right. The right Christian things to be doing. If we do those, it's not a bondage, it's not legalism. It's doing what's right, and the devil will tell you it's legalism and bondage. It's doing what's right, don't listen to him. It's doing what's right so you can hear God and not end up doing what's wrong. Do what's right, friend. We know it's right to get a few moments earlier in the morning and pray. We know it's right to talk to the Lord before we go to sleep. We know it's right to study and read our Bible. And we know it's right from time to time to fast. Some people never fast at church. The church doesn't preach fasting. And yet Jesus said, when you fast, not if you fast. There are ways to keep our flesh down and to keep us in the love of God. For God so loved us that he gave. And we can give some of our time, some of what it is we do, to the things that God would have us to do. And yet, it's not seemingly doing it for God, because we end up benefiting from it for ourselves. It's one of those strange things. We do something for God, it requires an effort, it requires, well, yes, a sacrifice. But in doing it, we get blessed. So, what is the sacrifice then? But it takes time to grow in that and to know that. Let's bow our heads. We thank you, dear Lord, that you are causing fruit to grow in us. We thank you for the admonition and the exhortation today that we have to bring forth fruit, or men gather us and we're bundled. We're cast forth and withered. We thank you, Lord, that our fruit is healthy today, and we ask that you would help us as we move forward in growth with you, that we would keep healthy fruit, keep short accounts, and find, Lord, that we are walking afresh again with you. Lord, if there be anything that you need to put your hand on, that you need to convict us of, we are waiting and ready for that call to your heart. Friend, open your heart. The first pathway to victory is God asking the removal of what shouldn't be there. Don't be afraid or frightened of that. Whom the Lord loves, he chastises. Ask the Lord if there be anything blocking your walk. Ask him to remove that. And pour in the oil and bless you to get up and go on with him in a new season in the love of God. Amen and amen.